What is going on, everybody? How is everybody doing today? So the NBA season is right around the corner. Literally on Sunday, the preseason starts. I think we got Lakers versus Nets. And I'm going to be giving you guys a top five players I like this season and five players I don't like this season. So this is going to be the five players I do like this season. Now, it's going to be a little bit different from the breakout list players because those are guys that I think could break out, but not necessarily that I like them a lot this year. These are just five guys that I think are going to end up this season better than where the public perception has them right now. Like, if you're looking at maybe those lists that were created, the top 100, they're going to finish a little bit better at the end of the year. And yeah, it's just five guys. There's obviously a lot more players I like on this list, and I could also think like Anthony Davis has a bounce back year this year, but he is not included on this list. We have some good players, and we have some players that are like not elite players as well. And yeah, just remember, this is just random five guys that I like. Pretty random, but yeah, we can get into it right now, and let's see what number five is. So this isn't in any type of order or anything, but the first guy that I really like, or you could say that I love for the 2022 season, is Darius Garland of the Cleveland Cavaliers. So in hindsight, maybe I should have put Garland in my top guys that I think are going to break out next season because I included a lot of players from the 2019 draft class like Keldon Johnson, RJ Barrett, and Kevin Porter Jr. But I did include Darius Garland, who might be actually the best out of those three players because like his jump from his rookie year to his sophomore year was incredible. He went from 12 points in his rookie year to 17.5 points, 4 assists to 6 assists, under a steal a game to over a steal a game. Now his free throw percentage did drop, but he got to the line a little bit more, so maybe just a higher volume means he was going to go down in free throw percentage. His 3-point percentage went up when he took the same amount of threes, 5 a night. He went from 35% from 3 to 39.5% from 3. Yeah, basically 40%, which is amazing. But the thing I loved most, he took 12 shots his rookie year and hit them at a 40% clip. Last year, he took 15 shots and hit them at a 45% clip. And he also got a little bit better on defense. And his ball handling, you kind of noticed maybe his dribble moves were getting a lot better. And dealing with just a poor Cavs team, there was obviously internal problems with once he entered the NBA with John Beilein, already issues there. His rookie season was cut short due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The one leader, the main veteran on the team that has championship experience, Kevin Love, is just a horrible leader for them. We're going to see what's going on. Is he going to get bought out? He doesn't want to lose the money. No team's going to want to trade for him pretty much. So yeah, he's without really his main veteran, but I think he's due to a big year and poised for a big year. And I think the Cavs could be maybe a little bit surprising, maybe be a like flirting with that playing tournament team because you got Sexland, you got Okoro, you got Markkanen, you got Mobley, you got Jared Allen. They're a fun team, don't get me wrong. And I think Darius Garland could end up as maybe the best player out of all those guys I mentioned this year on just kind of overall on offense, on defense. Maybe if he puts up better numbers than he did last year can flirt with an all-star game appearance. And I think he's just getting better on the defensive side of the ball. And I think just maybe adding Lowry, Markkanen, and Evan Mobley could just open up so much for Garland when it comes to the pick and roll and the pick and pop and just kind of DHOs and etc. So I think Garland is due for a big year and I love him a lot. Next up, we got Robert Williams, the Time Lord of the Boston Celtics. So the Time Lord, Robert Williams, was drafted in 2018. He was the 27th overall pick, and he really had disappointing first 2 years in this league, but he was behind a bunch of veterans throughout those 2 years, like Al Horford, like Enes Kanter, like Daniel Tice. There was just a bunch of guys in front of him. And last year, he kind of quietly broke out a little bit. 8 points, 7 rebounds, 2 assists. Yeah, the Time Lord can pass. 2 blocks, as well as being super efficient inside the paint at a 72% clip. I think he got a lot better when it came towards the end of the season, and I don't think he played all that bad in the playoffs. Now, obviously, the Celtics had to completely change up their game plan without Jaylen Brown. They were playing arguably the most talented team in the league in the Brooklyn Nets, so they were really never going to be able to run any bit of offense through Robert Williams. But I think with Tice gone, they did bring back Enes Kanter and Al Horford, but it's looking like Al Horford might start at the four. Robert Williams is going to get the full-time starting five center minutes, and I am very excited because he's gotten better on the defensive end, which I think is huge. If he's going to be kind of molded after that Clint Capela style of play, that's your rim protector, your rim runner, just there to really get offensive rebounds, catch alley-oops, and just be efficient inside, basically Rudy Gobert and a lot of other centers that can't shoot in this league. And that's completely fine for Robert Williams. So I think as long as he could just stay healthy this year, he averaged 8 points and 7 rebounds in 19 minutes. per game last year. His per 36 numbers would have been 15 points and 13 rebounds. So I think if he stays fully healthy, he can average around 25, 26 minutes, and he stays out of foul trouble, which he flirted a little bit with last year. I think he could be a very promising young center because he's going into his age 24 season. He'll be 24 on opening night, just gonna pretty much turn 24 right before the season starts. But yeah, I think if he plays a decent amount of minutes, he doesn't get hurt, stays out of foul trouble, he could be some guy that we're looking maybe scoring 12 to 13 points, 9 to 10 rebounds, over 2 blocks a night. And we're like, yeah, he's one of the better young centers in the league, and he was definitely deserving of that new contract extension. Forgot to mention that. Yeah, that contract extension is going to show why they're going to play him a lot of minutes this year. I'm excited for the Time Lord. The next player on this list is a sharp shooting 22-year-old out of Detroit. Well, really, he's out of Charlotte, North Carolina, but he plays for the Pistons, and that is Sadiq Bey. Sadiq Bey was supposed to set the rookie season record for three-pointers made in a year if they played a full season. Now, he only played 70 games last year, so he missed two, but in a full season, if he was able to play 10 more games, he was probably going to beat that record. He averaged 12 points, 4.5 rebounds, shot 84% from the line, which is incredible for a rookie. 40% from the field, which isn't great, but hey, he shot 38% from three on 6.5 attempts a night. I think Sadiq Bey was definitely a top five rookie last year. Now, obviously, you had your Anthony Edwards, your Halliburton, your LaMelo Balls, but I think he was right there as possibly the fourth or the fifth best rookie out of the 2020 class last year. And this man is an absolute sharpshooter, and I'm just excited for him this year where he's going to get even more volume. I'm hoping to see him take more than 10 shots a night. Now, Ed and Kelly Olynyk won't help, and obviously Cade Cunningham, but I'm hoping by the addition of Cade Cunningham can set up more Sadiq Bey off the ball movement, and he can actually get maybe a very good point guard. Now, like, Sadiq Bey, not bad. They went through some veterans, but Cade, I think, is going to get the job done for Sadiq Bey next year, and I wouldn't be surprised if he was the second leading scorer behind Jeremy Grant. And I think since he is in Detroit, it's a small market team, he's not going to get a ton of recognition, but I'm just excited to watch some Sadiq Bey next year. So the next player you could basically say is a superstar in this league. I'm just thinking he's going to have a very big year now that he's the number one option due to injury for their other guy. But yeah, that is Paul George, if you couldn't guess it, of the LA Clippers. And the reason why I say this is because no Kawhi Leonard. If you watch Paul George in the playoffs, I think we can kind of all come to the assumption that he might be better as a number one. And the reason why he wasn't great with the Clippers last year is just he doesn't maybe fit that great with Kawhi. So Kawhi or not, which we know there's no Kawhi this year, Paul George, I think, is due for a very big year. He's a borderline top 10 guy in the league. I would say that he is not a top 10 player because you would have AD, Lillard, Embiid, Jokic, Lillard, Luka, Harden, Kawhi, Giannis, Curry, LeBron, Durant. There's a bunch of guys you'd probably have in front of Paul George. And you would say he's like 12 at the moment. But I think there is a chance that Paul George can have a better year than Anthony Davis, maybe Joel Embiid, maybe Damian Lillard. And he could be a top 10 player in everybody's eyes going into the 2023 season. I think he's also going to be in the MVP conversation. I wouldn't bet on him to win it. I know a lot of people are maybe high on him to win the award. I don't think he's going to be that good because I don't think the Clippers are going to be a top 3 or 4 seed in the West. I think they're going to be more around that 6 to 8 seeds, and I'd probably prefer maybe betting on Giannis, Luka, LeBron, and Curry. But I love Paul George next year. I think he's going to be on an all-NBA team and an all-defensive team. He's going to be an all-star, and I think he's going to lead the Clippers to the playoffs while also kind of going back to his 2019 OKC days. And then my final player that I just absolutely loved next year and I'd buy all his stock is another player that is going to get a bigger role due to an injury of another player on his team, with Jamal Murray, and that is going to be Monte Morris of the Denver Nuggets. The king of the assist to turnover ratio. Just, I love this player. He passes the ball well, he doesn't turn it over. He shoots efficient from the field, 48 from the field, 38% from three, 80% from the line. And yeah, like I just mentioned, he doesn't turn the ball over. He doesn't get into foul trouble. He's a very smart player. And I just love Monte Morris. And I'm so excited to watch him play 30 plus minutes this year. Now, it does suck. It comes at the expense of Jamal Murray being hurt for the first half of the season. But either way, I think Monte Morris is due for a breakout year. And we're going to be looking at him as one of the best contracts in this league because he's making $8 million this year, $9 million next year, and then $9.5 million fully guaranteed the year after that. I think he's due for a breakout year. I don't think he's going to be anything like, oh, he's an all-star, or oh, he's a top 10 point guard in this league. But now I think there is a good chance that Monte Morris can increase that 10 points to 14, 15, maybe 13, possibly those assists from 3 to 5 or 6. and just set up Jokic, set up Porter Jr. I think Morris is due for a big year, and I'm going to be very excited to watch the Denver Nuggets and especially Monte Morris on League Pass. So yeah, that is my list. It's just a quick five guys that I think could be a lot better this year, or just better than what they are perceived in the public perception right now. Anybody else that you think I mentioned or didn't mention that you think I should have, let me know down below. I try to restrain from anybody I put in the breakout list video because obviously I like Keldon Johnson this year. Obviously I like Kevin Porter Jr., RJ Barrett, or Michael Porter Jr. So maybe these are just five guys that I think haven't been getting enough like love, basically. Maybe that's a pun intended for my five guys I don't like. But yeah, thank you for watching. I love you guys. I'll catch you on the next one. Peace.